morning.
Good morning
and welcome to Hope Presbyterian Church. It's a joy to be with you this morning as we gather to worship. I'm Pastor Todd Johnson here at Hope to dispense with some of our normal, typical things. We are a community all about finding hope in Jesus and extending that hope to others, one another and others in our community, all men and women that we encounter. So I welcome you in that good news of what Jesus is doing to worship. A few other normal things to dispense of. There should be PDFs of the worship guide back there, printouts of the PDF, actually. I don't know how you'd fold a PDF. Because as you know, in an age that wants to entertain and just have us sit, we believe that part of what we can form ourselves in right now is the fact of participation. Participating with one another and participating in God's plan. And so in our worship, we have a lot of participation. Not because we love it, but because we want it to shape us, to be engagers. Anyway, that's like a mini sermon. Normal things. There's a printout of the PDF back there as well. Bathrooms are over that way by the baseball snack bar that is not open because we're having a picnic later. Or if you're a member of ACAC, you obviously can go here. I think those are all our details. Did I miss any normal things? Jesus does call us here to meet him. These normal things I just announced are normal. In many ways, we sit here in normal life, in our physical world, in the park, and yet this is our chance for the veil, to remind one another that the veil would get really thin between what is seen and what we sometimes fail to encounter and see. And so as that veil gets thin, let's enter in together and participate in the love and life of God. Let's pause for a moment of silence, prepare your hearts, and then Laura will be leading us through the first part of worship.
Amen. Let's be called into the worship of our great God. I invite you to stand, whether in body or in spirit, as you are able. The Lord reigns. Let the earth be glad.
Let the distant shores rejoice.
For you, Lord, are the Most High over all the earth.
You are exalted far above all gods.
Rejoice in the Lord, you who are righteous.
And praise his holy name.
Pray with me now, please. Lord God, our great God, who in your great love and mercy calls us your people, we do praise and adore you this morning as we are called into your presence. Echoing the words that we just sang to you in praise, we do acknowledge that you are a God who keeps his promises to us. Not a single one will fail. That Son, Jesus, Son of the Father, you would call us not enemies but friends and make a way for that to be fundamentally true of us. And Holy Spirit, who resides among us and in us, does attend to all of our hopes and fears. What a great God you are. There is none other like you. Powerful, beautiful, holy, rescuing God. Receive our love, our admiration, our praise this morning. Amen.
Thank you.
You may be seated, and we'll give our attention now to the reading of God's Word.
This reading is from Isaiah 40, 1 through 11. Comfort, comfort, my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem, and cry to her that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity is pardoned, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries, in the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry. And I said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all its beauty is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades. When the breath of the Lord blows on it, surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Go on up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good news. Lift it up, fear not. Say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom and gently lead those that are with him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks, John. Oops. So, some of you may have noticed that I'm wearing some wounds on my knuckles. And it would be a reasonable question to say, what is Laura doing with bloody knuckles? And I could very reasonably answer, you should see the other guy. But that wouldn't be the truth. It's a reasonable answer, but it's not the truth. The truth is I tripped on a concrete sidewalk, and for some reason, still unbeknownst to me, I caught myself with my knuckles, which is not a smart plan. I share that because we're coming to this place in our worship service called confession. And I think it's very tempting to come to this time where we tell God about what's wrong with us, and we give him reasonable answers. We give him answers, we tell him things like, yeah, I should have done better at that. Yeah, that person did this to me, and I should have been above board in how I responded. I didn't quite get that right. And those might be reasonable answers, but they really are not the truest answers. The truest answers lie somewhere deeper, like, I was selfish. I frankly care more about myself. I like comfort more than doing hard things for the sake of another. Why in the world would we want to name those truest things about us? And the only answer to why in the world we would want to be as honest as we can is because we have a God that meets us, who already knows those things, and then who gives us something truer. You'll see when we come to the prayer of confession, we're going to ask God not to remember our sins. It's not to say, ignore them, pretend they didn't happen. We're asking God to call into his interaction with us something that is more true, a bigger story, because there's a bigger story than our sin. And that bigger story is the God who meets us and does what he longs to do when we ask him, give us forgiveness and grace. So as we go now, resist the temptation to give reasonable confession and instead give him the truest part of that sinful heart, that he might meet it with the full force of his love and forgiveness. Please join me as we pray together. Remember, Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from of old.
Do not remember the sins of my youth and my rebellious ways.
According to your love, remember me.
For you, Lord, are good.
Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in his ways.
Look on my affliction and my distress, and take away all my sins.
And hear now, God, the truest parts of our sin. Assurance of the gospel. Brothers and sisters, what can wash away our sins?
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
We are brothers and sisters through his blood.
We have died together. We will rise together. We will live together.
I invite you now to rise in that hope, whether in body or in spirit. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is no deceit.
It is good news.
I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. And you forgave the guilt of my sin.
Thanks be to God.
And now, having been given peace with the Lord, I extend it to you. The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Please greet one another in that greeting of peace now.
Peace be with you all.
With you.
Also with you.
That he made us with dignity, but we don't fill it in. And so we've moved to confession and then assurance, singing the whole time to engage our deepest parts, and now we come to giving back because God has given us grace and mercy and forgiveness. And so though in COVID we might not pass an offering plate, you obviously can put offering in the tin that's there, but you also can give online. But this movement is a movement, as we are Jesus-shaped people, we want to have. And so we engage that movement of our hearts with this prayer. Join me in the prayer you see printed based on Acts 20. Jesus, you said, "It's more blessed to give than to receive. I offer you all that I am and all that I have. Receive these gifts. Amen." Amen. Things going on in the life of our family. Let me just remind you, you see this, we have a picnic afterwards, and we are back to Brownsville Fried Chicken. I've already talked to a number of you. It's like been on my heart all day. We are going to be masked up and safe. Please, if you weren't planning, we will have plenty of food, some chicken. We have individually wrapped chips, things. People will be masked with gloves. We're going to be as safe as we can and stay and hang out, visit with us. So I invite you to that. At 4:30 tonight, the 4:30 community group continues launching here for the fall. It's men's night as we do our men's women's rotation for things. So join us there. Talk to me if you need details. At 5:30, the youth are gathering at the Krumas tonight. And then as well, you saw in the email that we continue to need setup help. So this stuff right here, Laura has been faithfully doing it. There are a few of you who have agreed to help here and there, but we need some more. And what a great way to serve, to plug in, to give back. So if you are able, please talk to Laura about that. Now let's pray. We do want to pray about a number of things going on in the life of our family. I am going to be praying for, I was just made aware of one need of a woman named Patricia, who has an older woman in our community that has trouble eating. And so we want to be praying for her as we love and care for our community. Also, Majnik is happening, as you saw in our Friday emails. If you don't get our Friday emails, let me know and we can get you hooked up on those. But that is kingdom spelled backwards, in the upside down backwards community God calls us to be. And you can imagine all around the state of Virginia right now, middle school students have hopefully safely descended and are hearing about the good news of Jesus. You know how God works often when that happens. And so though we didn't send a whole great group, we have Emma is there. We want to pray for her. Anyway, so we'll pray for these things. And then as well with yesterday's anniversary, we want to pray for our country. We are a worldwide church, not an American church, but guess where we're sitting? And we want to care for this community. So I'll pray there. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pray for, it's going to be more pastoral. Some of these first things that I mentioned needs in our church. I'm going to pause for a moment of silence for you. It's prayers of the people to lift up concerns you are aware of and to pray silently for them. And then finally, I'll come back and we'll pray in light of yesterday. Okay? Let's pray. God, again, we gather as your people in awe of your goodness to us, that you right now are inclining your ear, that you are wanting to hear these needs, and that not just that, we aren't talking just out into the air, that as this veil is thin, you take the real needs of our world, the real concerns of our heart, and you work. Thank you. It is such good news that we are restored into relationship for you to be working in us and through us and in our prayers. And so we pray first for ourselves that you would continue this good work. Make us your people of love, of holiness, of joy, of peace. And as we pray that, and so many other things in that even idea for ourselves, we pray it for the middle school students that are at Majnik. We pray it for Emma, but we pray for all of them that are there as well, Lord. May they be drawn more fully into your life, your love, your work, your good news of what you are doing. So bless them as they come back. May they have a greater reality of who you are. May their lives not be the same. We ask too, Lord, for Patricia, someone in our community who is struggling, and we pray, Father, that you might please heal, help, give her family wisdom and doctor's wisdom on how to move forward and care for her. But she is just also one microcosm, Lord, of where we think of neighbor and friend with needs. And so now, Lord, hear the silent prayers that we lift up, for there are many concerns that we all could share. So hear the silent prayers of your people. And finally, Lord, we pray for our country. Lord, yesterday was a day that kicked up a bunch of emotions again for so many of us. And so as we as a country mourn and grapple with the way things are, would you please work to be the comforter that you are in the midst of grief, in the midst of mourning, and in the midst of evil, even. We do pray. As we ask for many nations in the world, often we pray for this nation and ask that you, Lord, would even use this anniversary to awaken hearts to you, to call people back to peace and love, and that again, in finding comfort in you, they might truly turn and engage with the gospel story and become your people. We pray, Lord, as we think of this time for our country, we must pray for our leaders. You've asked us to, but we want to give them insight, give them wisdom from the national level, those serving in the executive, the judicial branch, the legislative branch. Father, bless them with wisdom. We pray for our state government. Again, the various aspects from our governor, to our representatives, to those serving in the courts. Give wisdom, insight, please. And we pray locally, Lord, from for Ann Malik, to others serving on the board, to those making local decisions. We pray that our leaders would, yes, keep us safe, but would move our country towards goodness, love, wholeness, and justice. And we ask, Lord, for leaders in the church too. We pray that your churches in this nation would be lights. Help, Father, to that end. We ask all of these things, Lord, knowing you love our neighbors, ourselves, our country, and the world more than we could. And all God's people said, amen. We now give our attention to the New Testament reading as John comes back up.
It's from 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 22 and 58. Now I remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Coming to hear God's word read and then taught, we want to ask for his help, and we do that in song. We introduced this one again last week. Join us. If you don't know it, you'll learn it. Timer is wanting me to buy the app instead of letting me open it. So yeah, how about that for a silly little interruption, but you want my timer to be happening. All right, there we go. Maybe. Number of years ago, actually before we had kids, so that's how long ago, Laura and I, it was a Friday night, and we were wanting some entertainment, didn't like what was on TV, and so we did something, kids, this is going to have to, you're going to be like, what is this? We went to a thing called Blockbuster, and all the older crowd laughs. That's because you used to have to, instead of just opening up your computer and hitting play, you had to buy these things that were big chunks of tape, and you would put them in a tape player, and they would play this VHS thing. Anyway, but so we went to Blockbuster that would offer all these movies that you could rent for the evening, and we were looking around, but we didn't really like what we saw. And then we found one, and we were like, this one's recent. And it has Dustin Hoffman and Warren Beatty. Those are pretty well-known actors. Never heard of this film, but, you know, these guys are great. Let's get this one. I'm not even going to tell you the name of the movie for reasons you will see. So we took it home, started watching it. And right away we're like, all right, this is kind of weird. There just didn't seem to be chemistry between the two of them. And then the longer we watch, it's about some some lounge singers who are just really not that good. And so they, in light of that, the only place they can get a gig is in Morocco. And they're in Morocco doing their lounge singing at these various lounges. And then with that, they get mixed up with the CIA. We're reading the back, like they're supposed to get mixed up with the CIA and the Emir of Ishtar and rebels who want to take it over. Ishtar, and you think, oh, this sounds exciting. Well, like I said, we were like, it's not. It just never developed. It never, like you had these weird scenes at the start and you're like, how is this fitting together? And the monologue wasn't really working. There just was no, what we might say, narrative arc. It just wasn't going anywhere. And so it's one of the only movies in my life I didn't finish. We ejected it after a while, and we're like, we are not finishing this movie. Then we did the reviews that, you know, you could barely, there was internet back then, barely. And it was like, everybody's like, oh yeah, this is like, this movie is just has nothing. You don't want, and we're like, why did we, this is why now you look on your phone before, right? But there, it just didn't go anywhere. There were just, the pieces didn't fit together. And it just was blah, it was frustrating. Have you read a book that does that? That you're like, you start into it and then you're like, I just can't finish this. It's not going anywhere. There's no plot. There's no storyline. Is our life like this movie? Does it have no storyline? Or does it have plot? Is it going somewhere? Do the individual pieces fit into an arc or not? And that's kind of a weird question that we ask, but we often ask it at church because it's one we must be considering. Because in this day, there are a lot of other options. And many of them would say, no, there really isn't an arc. But in this, what is this big story that you and I woke up in this morning? Is it going anywhere? Is it leading, or is it like this movie, just disparate things? I mean, think of some of the answers. I'm going to spend a little bit more time here at the front setting this up, because this is where we woke up. With many neighbors going, I'm considering Buddhism, which actually says life is an illusion. It's just this elusive nothingness that we need to get back to. A dream, a bubble is another word that gets used. Or another view of the arc would be a Hindu arc. The Vedas, their scripture, teaches that life is just a circle. And so it's death, birth, reburial, and then things burn up. And that's even not just our life, that's the life of society. So how do you find meaning in just this endless circle? Or, as you know, we sit here in America, there's the pre-modern and post-modern issues going on in our world. That is, pre-modern being this idea of mankind can reach the moon. We can do progress, and we are getting better. And that was the story for so many years, and even still lingering as I was growing up as a boy. But now we live in this post-modern age where we go, are we really progressing? I'm not so sure. And so we might just as easily destroy the world as easily as we might help the world progress. Which are we doing? And there's uncertainty and doubt. And so is this world making its way toward anything, or as the classic quote is used, and I use it many times, like Macbeth says, that this really is just a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, but signifying nothing. Which is it? I ask these questions, and I'm spending time drilling down, because again, we have a smorgasbord of options, and it fits with where we are, because we've been in this series called Being Aware. We're starting this year with this series because I want awareness to be our watchword this year. And we talked about that we need to be aware of God, that we need to be aware of ourselves, becoming self-aware. That was 3 weeks ago. Then we talked about being aware of his body, of relationships, of others within what he's doing in this odd thing called his body, the church, the family of God. Then last week we looked at what does it mean to be aware of everyone, of all mankind, of those in the body and outside the body, especially how do we serve those outside the body. But now we come to this next big idea that I want in our Being Aware series, and that is being aware of the story. Of the story. And so we have this passage that we're looking at from 1 Corinthians 15. Let me get open to it. I want to organize our thoughts around four questions, and the first ones will move very quickly, or four ideas. We'll move very quickly, so fear not, we won't be here for forever. Just, it might feel like it. No, I'm kidding. We're going to talk about the problem Paul is facing, how Paul doesn't respond, then how Paul does respond, and then why it matters. The problem Paul's facing, how Paul doesn't respond, how he does respond, and why it matters. So first, how Paul, the problem he's facing. In verse 12, I should have printed this, but this went to print too early before I went here. Paul talks about why he's writing what he writes, and that is, if you have a Bible, you'd see this. But in 12, at the end, I cut that out and we skip to the end of the chapter. In 12, he writes, now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there's no resurrection of the dead? You don't have that printed again, but that's what he does. Here's the thing. He says at the start of ours, do you see in verse 1? He says, now, I remind you. And then he just said, now, if Christ is not raised from the dead. His nows in Corinthians matter. Here's why. If you know the big picture of what Corinthians, this letter he wrote to Corinth. Corinth was a town where Paul had gone and started a bunch of Christ followers into a family of God. He planted this church. They then had been writing in correspondence, and in that they sent a delegation, because you didn't have the mailmen coming in rain and snow and sleet and all that stuff, or maybe every third day if you live in Crozet. Anyway, sorry, that was uncool. You would deliver letters yourself. And so they sent this group with a letter to Paul. And the first, they also brought an oral report. He goes, how are things going? So the first six chapters of 1 Corinthians, he's dealing with the oral report. This is, hey, I've heard, you hear him say, I've heard this. They told me this. I've heard this. And he's talking about that. In 7, He turns chapter 7, he turns the corner and says, now, concerning the things you wrote me about. They had sent him a list of things. And in 7, he talks about marriage. Well, guess how he starts 8? He says, now, concerning food sacrificed to idols. And then he goes on, and if you read Corinthians, you see now, he's addressing things. But for some reason, some of them are saying there's no resurrection from the dead. And so he says, now, you wrote me and wanted me to speak into this situation, right? Now, why they would say that, there's some debate, but it's mostly probably because of how he talks later, they looked at their bodies in a pagan way. That is, they were in Corinth, where Aphrodite and all these pagan shrines were. They'd been raised in this Greek and Roman culture, and it's this idea that the body, the physical, is bad. And so the goal is to separate spiritual, what really matters, from the physical. And so here's this problem, and it's making its way, and they're like, it's not that they didn't believe that Jesus had risen. You see at the end, well, here in verse 11, they did believe that. They didn't think they would, because they were still thinking in this old story, a pagan story, that the body was just going to decay and the spirit was going to go on. Okay, so that's the thing he's addressing. Now, before I move on to my next point, isn't it interesting that for many in our culture, that's their story? Not a pagan story. They wouldn't admit it as pagan. But don't most people think, hey, if I'm good, if I live, my body's going to rot. It'll be put in the ground. But hey, I'll live on forever. And the memory of mama is going on forever. So isn't it interesting just to stop and go, oh, actually our culture's not that different. This story of resurrection is unique to Christianity. That Jesus will come and there will be a bodily resurrection of all men and women. Anyway, we could talk a lot about that and its importance, but we're talking about the story. So first, the problem Paul's facing. Now notice, secondly, how he does not respond. How he does not respond. My point here again, I wish I had printed 12 and even 13. He does not go directly to Jesus' resurrection. Let me read 12 and 13 to you again. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there's no resurrection of the dead? But if there's no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. My point is simply this, because this is where I'm making, this is going to be a little thicker. I don't have as many illustrations today. He could have just started either there or at verse 5 of what we have, right? He could have just said, you know, that he appeared to Peter, to Cephas, then to the 12. He has these eyewitnesses. If the issue was they were saying there's no resurrection, he makes the argument from Christ's resurrection that this thing is happening and that we too will be raised. He could have just talked about Christ's resurrection and made that his issue. But instead, he doesn't. He talks about bigger stuff. He talks about a broader context. Do you see what I mean? He does not just say, oh, let's just talk about resurrection stuff because that's your issue, but he puts their issue in a bigger story. Now I'm on to point 3. That's where point 2 was really quick, right? So we'd said, what's the problem he's facing? People are saying this stuff about no resurrection. He's addressing it. When he addresses it, he doesn't go right at that issue. So that's what he doesn't respond and do. Instead, he has a lot more that he's saying. He's putting it in a story. Why do I say that? Look at the first verses of your printed passage. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the gospel I preached to you. Literally, if we were reading this, the word preached there means good newsing. Proclaiming good news or good newsing someone. So do you hear his repetition? I remind you of the gospel, which means good news, that I've been making a verb out of it, good newsing you on. He is reminding them of good news. That is, he says twice, according to the scriptures. Right? At the end of verse 3 and at the end of verse 4. Do you see that? That is in accordance with the scriptures. He is taking this issue of their debates, their life, what is happening in conversations, and he does it throughout this letter, and he is putting it in the context of the gospel, the whole big story of what God is doing. And this is where we have to stop and say, what is the gospel? What does this mean? Because again, you hear it often in our churches. I grew up for years and decades, and then I worked in campus ministry and thought this, that like Paul was sitting there and he was thinking, okay, Jesus came, he died, he rose again for our sins, to forgive sins. What? How do I explain this to people? What? I know, it's good news. It's not bad news, it's good news. And so he just said, he started sharing the gospel. But when we think that, and when I thought that for years, I missed all of the technicolor, all of the background, all that he's drawing from. What do I mean? Remember, I said that this, he said that the euangelion that I euangelizo you on, the good news that I'm good newsing you on, those two Greek words get used in the Old Testament according to the scriptures. Where do they get used? What is said? So first, let's look at the Jewish idea, because you have to look at that. But then also, there was a Roman idea of them. And this is where this point gets more thick and it's a little longer. First, the Jewish idea. If you were to look at the Greek Old Testament that had been translated just a few hundred years, 100 years before Paul, that's what he was using when he would spend time with Jesus. That's a lot of what we see them using, this thing called the Septuagint. It is a Greek translation of the Hebrew texts. This word, good news, gospel, euangelion is the Greek. It would get used in the time of David, in Samuel, and in Chronicles. When? When kings that weren't blessed by God died. When Saul dies, it says someone runs to tell David the good news, the euangelion. Why? Because the unordained king who was not following after God's heart had been thrown down. And the righteous God, after the righteous king, the one with a right heart, he screwed up, but the one with after God's heart, who had been promised to make God's plans go, was there. And you see it throughout, that in these messages, even with Absalom, it uses this, if you know the story, where that's another guy that tries to usurp David, that it says there's good news that comes because the king is still on his throne. Well, then God's people didn't live well under the king. They still rebelled and they went into captivity and exile. And in that time, the prophets pick up this word. The prophets pick up so that they're talking about good tidings in the Hebrew, but it gets translated in the Greek, euangelion, good news. Our passage, where did I put the Old Testament passage that was read here? You see it in verse 9 on page 3 of your worship guide. O Zion, herald of good news. O Jerusalem, herald of good news. And what is that good news? Behold your God. He comes with might. He comes to rule. The good news in the prophets is this idea that God is reigning. The right king that was pictured in David is on his throne and he is coming to set all things to right. Because why did they need to hear that in Isaiah's time? Because Babylon was ruling. And they did not care about the things of God, the promises of God, the goodness of God, the love of God. And Isaiah says that reign, that rule will be overthrown and God will come and he will come in his servant. And is this not the story of Scripture? You see Paul putting this issue of resurrection and life in the full context of God's story, because remember his full story. God existed in the Trinity. Eternal past, relating and loving and rejoicing in being. He was life. They loved each other, the Trinity, but then they made the world. They said, we must share this life. We must create, and they made life, and then they put man at the center, and they said, nurture life, cause it to flourish. But what did mankind do? They sinned. And what entered the world? Death through sin. Because not just shame and guilt of leaving a lawgiver or something, not just guilt, shame of leaving relationship, but we left the source of life, and so death occurred. But God said, I will not let this remain. And he promised a rescue. And so God set out through the course of the Bible for the good news to come, that a rescue to all that is dead would be turned into life, that there would be this reversal. And it took, as you see the Bible go, the good news coming and his people trying until finally God's servant comes, who says what? I am the resurrection and the life. That John would tell us, he was the Word made flesh, who was life that came. And so as life comes and life is destroyed for our sin, but then rises because death could not hold him, that life leaks out now into the world, Paul is saying. There is a new king ruler on the throne. And that life leaks into you, his people, and will one day come in its fullness when he returns, when we all rise again. It is a story of life. But you see how he is not just saying, well, let's just talk about the resurrection. He's saying, no, we must put it in the context of all that God has been doing throughout all time. You, Corinthians, he's saying, must see yourself in this story. One quick illustration. As many of you may know, I love The Greatest Showman. I don't know if you've ever seen The Greatest Showman. I have the DVD if you want to borrow it. But there's a scene early in The Greatest Showman where P.T. Barnum, his father has passed away, and he's a pauper now, and he stands in front of the tailor shop, and this might have been before his father passed away, but he looks in the window, and in the window is a little mannequin with a top hat and a beautiful red coat with tails. Those of you that know P.T. Barnum is the circus master, that's what he wears, right? But he's a little teenage boy, and as he looks, the camera turns, and it perfectly fits him through the glass so that the hat is on him and the tails, he's wearing the coat. And you see a picture of going, that's who's really in that skin. But you must see through the glass to do it. Paul is saying, you must see through to see the real story of what's going on. Because this brings us to why it matters. We've talked about the problem he's facing, how Paul doesn't respond, how he does respond, and why it matters. Why it does matter is for this reason. I said before there was a Jewish idea, there also was a Roman idea of the euangelium. Augustus, Caesar. And I found a webpage this week that lists all of the places where ancient Greek writings uses euangelion. And you see it again, this idea of a king. But just about 40 years before this time, this letter was written, a little bit more, 50 years, this is an inscription has been found that heralds the supposed benevolent reign of Caesar Augustus. It says this, the birthday of the god Augustus was the beginning of the good news that came through him to the world. The euangelion is that we have a new ruler, and it's Caesar Augustus, and he's establishing towns, and he's controlling with power, and he rules the world. Get in line with his program. And so the coins would be minted, and they would say years later, his son, Tiberius, the emperor, the Caesar, the Lord. Caesar is Lord, was the declaration. The son of the divine Augustus, the high priest. And so imagine being in Corinth, and every morning, because you didn't have refrigeration, you got up to get your eggs and your bread, and you gave your coin to the person you were buying it from. And you saw on your coin, Caesar, the high priest. And it was an invitation. Who's high priest for me today? And you saw Caesar is Lord all over. You had propaganda all over telling you a different story of reality. And you had to come back to say, no, this is reality. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is high priest. God's story is a bigger story than any other arc that people are trying to sell me that God has made. That sin broke, that he is remaking it. And it will one day be made new. And that story had to be impressed in my life. Why? Because look at verse 3. I delivered over to you what was of first importance, that you also received, that Jesus died for our sins. He was buried. Paul reminds them that life is also full of atrocities, of injustices, of lack of love, of sin. And in that truth and reality, I may look at this coin and despair or feel hopeless. Because actually the brokenness of the world might shout at me louder than this story that I'm supposed to believe about God. That actually the sin of my own heart might feel like a trump card that gets played. That says, no, 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 God is not bringing life into the world, right? Because I just feel death in myself and I see death in the world. And Paul is saying it's a lie from the pit of hell. Don't you dare believe it. The truest story is that God has been working his good plan out through all time. And you, Corinthians, are to see yourself in that story. You, Hope Presbyterian Church, are to see yourself in that story. As we live this season being aware, that is the context and the story which we come to, because it's the story of hope. It's the story of reality of what God is doing. As I think about being aware of God and what is he doing, then I think about being self-aware that we've talked about. Where do I fit in this story? Where is that story not working its way into my heart? As I think about others in the church, we're bringing that story to bear in faith for one another. If you have trouble believing, I will believe it for you. I will help carry you when you're weak, and you will carry me. As I look at the world, I'm saying to them, this is the story. I'll just read this to you. The National Association of Evangelicals has a post in light of this on a blog, and it just says this. So finally, what is our part as we live the gospel? To live in light of the reality of Christ as King and Lord. When we look at the world today, from natural disasters to human violence towards one another to hunger and starvation, it may seem difficult to speak with conviction. Jesus is Lord? Yet that is precisely the faith stance the New Testament leads us to confess. Romans 10 says we say Jesus is Lord. And if Jesus, the one who brought justice and mercy in his ministry, is reigning and working to bring justice even in the center of such present ambiguities, we know that all things will be brought under his gracious and benevolent reign. That is our story. The truth of the gospel is an announcement of the kingdom of God, now firmly planted in the world in Jesus' reign. We're called to pass this good news along, to proclaim and teach it. We are called to pray it, may your kingdom come. And we are called to live it as we live out kingdom values. For we are to be aware. I'll conclude with this. I hope many of you children have read or watched the Chronicles. I guess I've got movies on the mind today. Chronicles of Narnia. But as you know, C.S. Lewis creates this world where Aslan, the great king, has vanquished the White Witch because she always made it winter and never spring. And then you see the other stories from Prince Caspian to the Voyage of the Dawn Treader to the Silver Chair on to the last battle. You get into the world and see what's going on in this Narnian fantasy world. But if you notice, if you read those stories, Narnia is not some land out there. It's right here. Think about the last battle, where a doorway is made and you just step into Narnia. You see, C.S. Lewis wrote it that way because he had this idea of God's story. And he said, I know there is a veil that wants to say, no, 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 there's other stories. There's other realities. There's other things. And he's like, you don't understand. Jesus is risen now. His life is offered to you now. He does reign now. Just, we're having trouble finding the doorway, maybe. There's a doorway, though. He is the door. Let us step into this story more and more as he calls us into it. Let's pray. our great God and Father, lover of our souls, magnify yourself in us, continue to help us as we work out your virtues, your values, the calling into your story and plan. For it is good news, and we declare that Jesus is Lord. And all God's people said, amen, 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 amen. Let's stand and sing as we prepare for the table. Seated. We gather around this table right now because I don't know about you, but even I can feel the length of my sermons on that one. And it's like, okay, yeah, Jesus, Jesus. So Jesus gives us another little quick way where we don't just have it go into our guts through our ears, but that reassures us through the mouth gate, as my seminary professor said. And so he invites you to this table of faith, this table where what we just tried to talk about, his good news of reworking the world through his final having to come to set things aright, through his living how we never could, through his then death for our sin and rising from the dead, is pictured here. This meal that he gave us, pictured in his body broken for us. But the white bread that is first clean and pure as he was, living as we never could, and then his blood shed to forgive our sins. If that is your faith, this is your meal. If you believe he lived, died, rose for you, you've made that public through baptism and membership in a church that heralds this good news. Come eat with us. If that is not your faith yet, we're so glad that you're here. We know people are all over. There's no embarrassment knowing that people are considering these claims of Jesus. And did he actually rise from the dead? There's no, we understand people are different places, but this is a meal of faith. And if it's not yet your faith, we ask you not to eat this meal. You can just keep your hands down and that's fine. Again, there's no harm, no oddity in that because we understand folks are different places. But here we see our Jesus, given and broken for the world. Let's thank him for this meal. Jesus, we look to you and ask that you would use these normal things to impress upon us your love, even just a baby step more. In your name, amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he'd given thanks, as I did in his name, he broke it, said, "This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This blood is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." We're going to use our response that we've been using here in ordinary time in a bit, but for right now, we will distribute the wafers in the cups. So let's prepare our hearts as we receive them and work back the little tabs. Prepare our little
for the tabs.
Tabs. You are not familiar, keep working your tab back and forth till the clear part separates from the foil. Then you want to peel that back for the wafer, and we will peel back later for the juice. But we use this response, remembering that we join, this is from Africa, we join with the worldwide church on this response. So let's remind ourselves, is the Father with us?
He is.
Is Christ among us?
He is.
Is the Holy Spirit here?
He is.
This is our God.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
We are his people.
We are redeemed by his grace.
Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Christ our Passover, sacrifice for us. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. The bread of life was broken and crushed for your sin, that you might have life. Eat, all of you who believe. Now, peeling back the foil, Jesus, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, has shed his blood for you who believe. Drink, all of you. For I didn't say it that we may finish here. Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
The gifts of God have been given for the people of God. Hallelujah. Let's stand and sing of his glorious reign with these last two verses. You that we point to the cross, we invite you to point to the cross with our first three responses, then we point up where Christ ascended with our last one to embody some of what we're seeing. All our problems we send
to the cross of Christ.
All our difficulties
we send to the cross of Christ.
All the devil's works
we send to the cross of Christ.
And all our hopes
we set on the risen Christ.
I invite you to stretch forth your hands and receive his historic, because we stand in a story. Good news. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you his peace. Amen.
John is our reader. Send us out of here. We go forth to love and serve the Lord. You are dismissed, but obviously Lou has taken off. The chicken's on the way here. It will be here in a little bit to visit and catch up, and we will pray over it and give you directions after a while, so just stay and visit. I do want to say this while I have a microphone, is we are outside, so things are much more safe, but please maintain safety distance. If you desire to wear a mask, there's nothing wrong with that, just because we can get a little closer than 6 feet. We want to be safe and mindful on that, and again, we'll be safe here. If you have concerns, let me know.
Todd, tell people to approach the table with masks.
Oh, yeah. Make sure you, I said that last week and I forgot. Please wear a mask when you approach the table. There are some under the bin over there if you need one. So, yeah.